folks, Dave here at Thunder Mesa Studio, where I'm heading back to Thunder Mesa Town for another structure build. This time, it's the Assay Office, my version of a classic structure from the little mining town of Rainbow Ridge at Disneyland. So this is a mock-up that I built of the Assay Office probably more than 10 years ago. I built it, I plunked it on the layout, moved it several times, but really haven't thought about it much since then, to be perfectly honest. But the time has come now to replace this mock-up with an actual built-out, finished structure. For those not familiar, this Assay Office is based on a structure at Disneyland, which sits next to the Big Thunder Saloon, just like it does here on the Thunder Mesa layout. And it actually dates back to the original mining town of Rainbow Ridge from the mine train through Nature's Wonderland. And it's yet another adobe structure, which I think I'm going to build out of MDF, the way I've done a few others. And so what I'm going to do now, I think, is take this home, take some measurements, draw it out again on the computer in Adobe Illustrator so I can cut some laser cut walls and doors and windows and things for it. So that's the next step. Let's get this done. Well, a couple hours messing around in Adobe Illustrator and a little bit of time on the laser, and I have got some laser cut walls to begin construction with. Well, I decided to cut my walls out of some 3/16 inch thick MDF, which takes a little bit of time on the laser, but it's worth it because I want to represent those thick adobe walls. I made one or two changes from the design of the Disneyland original. For one thing, the original has a peaked roof, and I decided I wanted a kind of a lean-to slanted roof going back towards the back, which is a little bit more typical of what I see on these kind of adobe structures. Start off gluing the front wall to this side wall. I've already cut a floor. This is out of some 1/16 of an inch thick MDF. And I'll use that to try and keep things square during construction. I also want to glue in the other half of the chimney because it's going to be finished in the same way as the rest of the walls. Now I'm going to take some spackling compound and press this in here just to fill in any gaps there might be around these tab and slot joints because I don't want them to show on the finished model. Let that dry and then go back and get some sandpaper on those corners. And I might need to do it again, but we'll see how it looks. Now, as you may have seen me do on other adobe structure builds, I want to go around with some sandpaper and round off all of the corners, including around the doors and window openings, because that really, really goes a long way to give it that adobe structure look. Just using some 150 grit sandpaper. Get that done. Want to get all around the top of the building too, along these crenellated edges. Now the prototype has this kind of decorative ridge that runs along the crest of the front of the roof here and wraps around the sides. So I'm cutting it out of some illustration board. You might wonder why I didn't go ahead and just laser cut it, you know. I have a really good reason for that. I forgot. Yeah, I forgot to do it. you watched my video on the building the Southwestern Trading Post, you probably have a pretty good idea what comes next. If you guessed Crescent Creek Models, scale stucco, give yourself a prize. Just gonna stipple that right on there. The MDF, I don't really need to prime it first. If I was using basswood or something thinner, I would probably prime the walls first before doing this step. But MDF, this is nice and thick. It's not gonna warp. These slots above the doors are sized to fit 6x8 lintels, like so. I've already cut these to length, so now I'm just gonna de-stress them a little bit and stain them up with some India ink and alcohol mixture. So by the time the paint is dry on this, these will be ready to install. Well, now I've let all that dry overnight. Now I'm just taking some 400 grit sandpaper, going around over the whole thing and knocking the texture back just a little bit. For the main wall color, I think I'm going to mix about half and half of this apple barrel light mocha with some unbleached titanium to lighten it up a little bit. By the way, Dixie cups, very handy for mixing paint that you need. And to keep it from drying out, what you can do is take the whole cup, stick it inside a Ziploc bag with a wet paper towel on top. Keeps the paint for a good long time. You can make it last 2 or 3 days that way. That's the color we're looking for, that kind of Navajo white, adobe beige. Applying this with a soft brush. You might notice that on this structure, as compared to the Southwestern Trading Post I just did, which used a lot of similar colors and techniques, this one doesn't have any exposed adobe bricks. And the reason for that is, the prototype doesn't have any. The prototype that I'm looking at, the model this from, is supposed to represent a boomtown structure, something that's relatively new. So it wouldn't have that broken chipped adobe, or that broken chipped plaster, I should say, exposing the adobe bricks. And now I've got another little bag of laser cut goodies. See what's in here. This is the top of the porch. These are the beams for the porch. I cut a new floor out of some 1/8-inch basswood because I wasn't really happy with the first one I did. Got some laser cut doors and windows made from 25 thou laser board. A lot of people ask me where I get this stuff. I'll put a link down below so you can check it out. And most importantly, for the next step, I've created a stencil for the Assay Office lettering. Now, here's a fun fact. Let's come down the rabbit hole with me. This this lettering is not the lettering that you see at Disneyland now. This is actually the original lettering from Rainbow Ridge, and it was on a different building. The building that is now the Gold Nugget Saloon was originally the Assay Office, and this one was called, had said Comstock Block up here, and it was like on the street up above. Anyway, a little bit of Disneyland trivia you didn't know you needed to know. I thought it would be fun to use that original lettering on here, so that's what I'm going to do. And for the stencil, I'm going to spray the back of it with some Super 77 adhesive, and then I can use an airbrush, mask everything else off, and use an airbrush to do the lettering. Well, that's the way it's supposed to work in theory anyway. We'll see how it goes. And you want to get a real thin coat on the back because we don't really want it to gum up the letters themselves. I'm using some golden airbrush acrylics, burnt sienna. That'll do, I think. Well, now we can pull the stencil off. See how much touch-up I need to do. Okay. Stencil itself off. Not too bad. See little places I need to touch up. Of course, I have to touch up the stencil cuts for one thing with the burnt sienna, but a couple of places I also need to touch up with the wall color. I've still got the airbrush out. I think I'm going to do a little pre-weathering around the base of the structure. I've got some Vallejo dark earth loaded up in my airbrush. Just going to go around the base. All right, I think that's good. I don't want to overdo it. Now, with all of that done, I can start installing these 6x8 lintels above the doors and windows. These little laser cut slots I've got going on here. I don't want them to go all the way flush. I want them to stick out proud just a little bit, about a 64th of an inch. Now I can start assembling all of these doors and windows and get them ready to be painted. So each of the windows gets built up in three layers. There's the back layer here, which contains the upper window casement, and then it's got a frame that goes around it like that. And then the inner window, which can be positioned up or down, the lower window frame, I should say. Each of these pieces of balcony railing gets built up with some scale 1x2s on the top and bottom rail. While I wait for the primer to dry on those doors and windows, I decided to move ahead on the balcony. I've got the laser cut piece. This is from some 16th of an inch thick stock, and I've stained it with a little Minwax Early American. Now I'm building the supports for it out of some 6x6. I already painted these. As you can see, I've mixed up a kind of a minty green to match what I've seen on the prototype. Just used about half and half Vallejo chrome green, blue, and then white to lighten it up. There we go. These laser cut beams just fit right into these slots. I've cut them with a sort of little Southwestern design at the end to match the prototype. These just go in flush with the interior wall. Some glue on the top of these beams. Meeting edge of this. Now I can go ahead and finish painting all these doors and windows. And naturally, before I install the doors, I had to build some door frames. So I made these out of some scale 1x4. Before I glaze these doors and windows, I want to dry brush on a little weathering. This is just some unbleached titanium. This will bring out the details in the door. Give them just a little wear and tear. Just glazing the last of the windows now. Got some clear acetate from my scrap box. And I'm using a little bit of Eileen's tacky glue to hold it on. If you do use Eileen's for this, I found that it's actually better to spread the glue out in a thin film rather than to leave little dabs, because that way when you push the acetate down onto the window frame, it doesn't cause the glue to spread out into the window where it's visible. If it's already spread out, you can't do that. Well, just drilling a couple holes here. Once again, I'm using shirt pins for doorknobs. I can get that through there. There we go. Little CA in the back. Since this is a business, I think it would have blinds in the window, at least downstairs, where the office is. So I've created some from some manila file folder paper. The windows have a little lip around the outside, which won't be visible when they're installed, and that gives me something to apply the glue to. The door should fit just inside this frame that I created. There we go. Well, for the 1, 2, 3 upstairs windows, I've decided to do some curtains. And I'm doing them pretty much the same way I did on Goldie's Place, if you happen to watch that video. Just taking some white crepe paper, about 1/4 inch, and then fold it over. So I need to make 6 of these, 2 for each window, 1 on each side. I put them at a bit of an angle. So you've got a little reveal there. For this one that goes on the side window, I've position the curtains so they're blowing out the window a little bit. Now you can trim off this overhanging portion here if it bothers you. Now on the upstairs door, I want to have a top curtain, which you often see, like so. That, let's trim that off. And these go behind this top curtain. There we go. Trim that off. All right, now I can fit all of these in their respective openings. I think I'll start with the door. You may have noticed I already went ahead and installed the floor in there. Stained it up with some Minwax Early American. Love these stain markers. Makes that job really easy. It's got a big hole in it. That's a 3/4 inch wide hole for the lights. I'm doing the lights a little bit different this time. They're not going to be integrated into the structure. They're actually going to be coming up from the layout, and the structure will fit right down over the top of them, so I don't have to worry about running wires or anything inside of here for now. So now what I'm going to do is dry brush on some of the wall color over the top of the lettering, very, very lightly and very carefully, to fade it back a little bit, give it a little bit of age, because it looks a little bit too new to my eye. Now I can just dry brush over the top here. making it look like it's been faded in the sun is the idea here. I think that's good. Well, now I'm ready to start finishing the balcony. And the first step is putting a beam to hang it on, for the roof, I mean, of the balcony. And this is just a piece of O-scale 2x6 that I've painted with the teal color. And I've got a couple of little, very faint pencil marks to guide me where this goes. Now the roof will hang right off of that. Now I'm just kind of guessing at the angle of the roof pitch coming off of here, but I think 15 degrees looks about right, so I'm going to cut some supports with that angle so I can build my balcony roof. So for the balcony roof, I've got a piece of 1/32nd of an inch thick birch plywood, which has been laser scribed very nicely top and bottom. These are the guides for shingles. And these are board detailed down below. And then I've measured off roughly 2 foot centers for the rafters. So that means I'm going to need 6 rafters, just like this, cut at a 15 degree angle at the end where it mates with the building. So I need to cut 5 more of these from my 2x6 material. For thin material like this, it's often easier to just cut it with a hobby knife than to use the razor saw. As long as you press straight down, you get a nice, clean, straight cut. Like so. I'm just matching these up so they're all the same. Now to give it a little stability and a nice finished look, I'm just going to glue a 1x6 along the front edge. Now I can paint this whole thing with the teal color to match the rest of the trim. Well, now I have cut 3 porch posts to length for the balcony here and matched the angle of the roof. So now I just need to glue these, each one into its hole that's been pre-cut in the deck of the balcony. This end, number 3. Those holes are going to hold them pretty straight up and down, but the thing that's really going to put them into place properly is this railing, which is cut to fit precisely between them. I'm going to start down on this end with one of the short pieces that goes between this post and the wall. Just work my way around. This one next. Now it is time to shingle the porch roof, and I've decided to use some shake shingles. I think they look good. These are some I've already got stained and cut from an earlier project. These are real cedar shingles, peel and stick. Though I found it's a really good idea to put glue at the ends of each row of shingles anyway, even though they're peel and stick, because sometimes they peel up. You want the shingles to, you know, about overlap by half, so sometimes you have to trim one at one end. A row ought to do it. Now I'm ready to install this porch roof. Just going to get a little glue on these posts. A little bit of glue on the back of this. It should just fit right like that. Oh, I love it when a plan comes together. Yeah. Now, realistically, there would be some flashing right here where the porch roof meets the wall. So I've got some copper tape. I'm going to put it right here in this joint where the roof meets the wall. It's a little bright and shiny, so I want to add some patina to it with some colored chalk. Copper, of course, does not rust, but it does oxidize green, so add some green oxidation to it. Now, in case you're wondering, this structure is not going to have a removable roof, and the reason for that is because I have no intention of ever removing it. So, just going to go ahead and try and slide these rafters in one by one. I'm going to glue that roof right down. It's a nice tight fit, just as it should be. All right. Well, I am ready now to finish the roof. I've got some black construction paper to simulate roofing paper that I've cut into scale 3 foot wide strips, 2.5 inches long. And I've got some diluted white glue. Just on the end piece, I'm going to pull this around and glue it underneath. Just makes for a neat look on the end of the roof. So now, before I do any more of the roofing paper, I want to go ahead and glue the roof panel into place on these beams. That way, when I do the rest of the roofing paper, I can actually curl it up and glue it to the sides of the building, just like would be done on a real building. These up. And on the ends here, just want to trim that. A little glue on there and then bend that down so it covers that exposed piece of roof there. And for the next strip, same thing. Just wet it down on there, line it up. I've drawn some lines here, which are a scale 2 feet apart. For the final one, I put a crease in it at one end, so it'll curve up onto the back of the front, so to speak. Get those corners in. And while that's still wet, I want to go and just take like a stick like this, and you can put some tears into the paper just to give it a little variety. Just making the place look kind of lived in, you know? Now I just want to take a thin strip, go around the base of the chimney, trim away the excess. Now to finish off the chimney, I've got this little smoke jack casting that I've cut off right here at the joint, painted it flat black. Used some CA to put part of a steel shirt pin into the bottom, drilled a little hole and inserted the shirt pin in there and glued it in. And now I have to glue a matching hole in the top of the chimney on the building to receive that. Now I'll use some thick CA on the end of this because I actually want it to ooze out around the sides just a little bit. Then I'll take some baking soda, put it on there. Now the baking soda kicks the CA, causes it to set faster, and also when I get a little black paint on there, it'll look like soot. Just using a little thinned black. Just want to touch it with the capillary motion. Pull it in. Now I want to do some weathering on the roof with chalk. So I'm mixing up some different shades of gray. Tone that black construction paper down a little bit. Now around the chimney, of course, I want some black soot. Let's use some black chalks for that. I'll get a little fix on that. Well, now it's time for a couple of signs on the front here. You know, this mock-up has been on the layout for about 10 years. And I think I would like for a little bit of it to continue to be represented on the layout. So I'm going to go ahead and use these signs that have been part of this mock-up all this time. I'm just going to cut them off. So in a way, this one will live on. Get some Super 77 adhesive on the back and then glue them up on some Bristol board, I think, to add a little strength and a little heft to them. Cut these out carefully as I can. Trim on these signs, I'm going to just use some O-scale 1x2, and I'm coloring it with a brown Sharpie. Easy peasy. Now I can just paint the edges and the back with some Vallejo dark brown. This one hangs off the balcony, a couple of posts. And this one I think I can just glue to the balcony railing. Very last thing I want to do on this is add just a little bit more weathering by dry brushing on some of my unbleached titanium white. Just to tone down this teal green a little bit and, once again, give it a little age. Over here on the layout, I've already prepared the site for the assay office. In fact, it's been prepared for quite a long time. But recently, I added these lights. These are 2 3-millimeter LEDs. One is yellow and one is a flickering yellow. And they just come up through this clear plastic tube right here, which I found in my scrap box. And the assay office will just fit down right over the top of that. Just like that. Now the way the scenery is sculpted here. Pretty much locks the building into place. I don't need any other mechanical ways of keeping it there. Let's flip the lights on and see how that looks. And that's going to wrap it up for this one. Thank you so much for watching that entire video. I really hope you enjoyed the build. Until next time, keep moving forward. Adios for now.